What is attention? What is the movement of attention? And what are the ways and methods of raising our attention? Today, as I am going to speak to you about attention, you should know that your attention should absorb all that I am saying. It is not meant for anybody else. You better sit in thoughtless awareness, that's the best way, so that it goes into you. Otherwise, it's like a lecture, you know. That you listen to me has no effect. Every lecture will transform you, because after all, I am speaking. But because you always think of others, and you think of your problems all the time, something nonsensical is going on, about which you are worried, and the attention is so overloaded that whatever is said to you doesn't go into you. So just now utilize it by being attentive and knowing that all these nonsensical things have no value. It's your attention that has to come up and has to grow. Attention is chitta, and God is attention. How far your attention has been enlightened is a different part. But your attention is God. If you become enlightened to that extent, it is like a canvas. You can say it is like a canvas which is spread out for a film. And your aptitudes, or you can say the drags or movements of your attention has, shows on that canvas. Our attention is just a pure, completely pure canvas, and is acted upon by the three gunas we have to begin with. And the three gunas come to you, as you know, one from your past, one from your future sense, and one from the present. Now, whatever have been your experiences about a particular thing or a particular occasion, so far is completely recorded in your memory. For example, if you see the black color, all that goes with the black color is recorded in your memory. As soon as you see this black color, quite a lot of it comes up. That means as soon as you see this with your attention, the attention gets muddled up, or you can say the attention gets colored with all the memories about this black color. And then your action takes place according to the way your attention is affected. It's the memory that tells you, oh, you are again possessed. Because your left side is weak, means you always live in your memory. Your memory is stronger than yourself. If you could make yourself stronger than your memory, nothing can possess you. But after you get the realization, you are not still identified with that state of mind in which you see your ego and superego as myths. Still you get caught up into your ego and superego. And that's why your attention is still in a mess. All the conditioning of all kinds come through that. Your reading, even the whole atmosphere can come to you. You see, sometimes you smell a particular soap or say a rose, you smell it. And all the memories of smelling such a rose sometimes comes to you, and you may feel really elated sometimes, maybe sometimes very unhappy, whatever may be the situation. So you may feel happy or unhappy, because whatever experiences you have had has given you a memory. This memory might have given you a superego or might have given you a ego. This scanning might have taken place. If it has been a ego and a superego, then maybe that if it was ego, you must have felt happy. If it is satisfying to your ego, you feel very happy. If it is not, if it is superego, if you are suppressed by this, then you feel very unhappy. So both things like happiness or unhappiness are the states where you are still in the myth. Still the myth exists. You have to still go beyond. So if you feel happy about some situation, you should know you are only happy before realization, because it is giving some support to your ego to bloat. And if you are unhappy, then you should know that there is some sort of a suppression on your ego and there is a superego developing. So both the situations have been of no help to you. Of no help to you for your growth, except that both these institutions develop so much that you are away from the real experience. The real experiencing stops because your attention is so much muddled up. So on one side, if you move on the left hand side, your attention is muddled up with fear, with pain, with unhappiness, with hopelessness, dejection. The other side, if you indulge too much onto the right hand side, little bit also, you start getting elated, excited, over dominating. The color of the left side is blue, and the blue color starts changing to the black. While on the right hand side, it is to begin with yellow, light yellow, or you can say golden, then yellow, then orange, and then red. So you go to aggression on the right hand side. On the left hand side, you go into a complete state of entropy, you can call it, or a state where you are separated from yourself into complete frozen state. So one side you become completely frozen, on the other side you become completely heated up. Both these things are again movement on the wrong direction. Even in the center, when the attention is kept, that you keep your attention more in the center, there also, because it's a very sensitive point, it doesn't stay there. For example, when we say use fire, we can use it for burning the house. In the same way, we can use it for creating smoke. But we can also use this fire in its proper way, if we use it in its proper proportion, for cooking the food, for giving us light. If it is too much, it can burn like a big fire. If it is too little, it can burn like smoke. But in the center, when you know how to balance it, then you can use it for your own purpose, for cooking or for giving light, and then for a puja too. So in the same way, when we really balance our gunas properly, then we become gradually the master of the whole situation.